There's a seat taken right here. Not me, the one you're in. This panel better not suck. Spent good money to be here.
Just put it up on top and get some air, bro.
Okay. turbo. Shift into turbo.
What?
Oh, no, no, no. Kick it and blow on it, just like a sailboat.
Smell that! Tell me it does not smell like they drained a dog with it.
Well, they do dog shows here, so.
Basket show. Okay.
You guys feel better now?
Yeah, a little bit. We got a little bit out. David always lets us run around before the panel so we can get out some energy.
Put all your money on the ground. He turned it down, didn't he?
Is there money in that wallet, Polly? Then you can pick it up.
The toy wallet. It's like a toy cell phone that has one text message on the screen forever.
Well, good morning, Utah. It's good to be here at Salt Lake City.
That is the Salt Lake right out there, right?
Ow! It was just there. It's ours. Like, the lights.
It's like one of those shoplifting schemes. They just put a perfectly good toy in the middle of somewhere. And they're secretly filming you to see if you take it.
Yeah, like 9 minutes ago. Sorry. Welcome to the Mighty Morphin Power Rangers panel, Corpus Christi, round of applause. We are very grateful that you're here, regardless of their show. But thank you. So basically it'll be like a question and answer panel. We're happy to answer anything you ask us, and we had a good panel yesterday, so I hope we'll have a good panel today. I'm sure we will. Thank you, Red Ranger, Blue Ranger, for wearing your morph suits. Love it. All right. So if you guys have questions, we'll make a line like right down here and make the line go that way so we don't block people. So if you have questions, come up to the front of the stage here and we'll go through them. So nobody has a question. Great. On the car? And you're gonna roll it around the room?
Yes.
Okay.
I guess the longest panel ever. History.
So if you have a question, I guess they're gonna wheel the car to you with the microphone on top.
No.
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 Okay. No. So we'll go back to plan A. If you have a question, come down here. Yay! You're on The Price is Right. Come on down. Here, you can come up closer so we can hear you and.
Was there anything on the show that you wanted Billy to do, just personally, that he didn't get to do or you didn't get to try out? Anything in particular, like a storyline maybe, or just a certain martial arts, anything like that?
Well, I mean, there's probably a lot of things that I wish would have happened for Billy. I did write an episode that I submitted to the producers about Billy, but they thought it was far too dark for Power Rangers. Yeah.
What happened to the episode?
I created a transformation monster, so the monster could like appear as anything it wanted to, and so it kept appearing as Billy's mom. And like in the story that I wrote, Billy's mom had passed away. Because we never see Billy's mom, so I was trying to give Billy some depth as a character, and so like his mom had passed away, but the monster kept appearing as Billy's mom, and that upset Billy a lot. So he went against the wishes of Zordon and the other Power Rangers and went off to Rita's, or Lord Zedd, I can't remember where we were in the season, went off to one of their chambers to fight them personally and take them on. But then Kimberly and Tommy came and said, Billy, you can't do this. And then we got trapped in Lord Zedd's dimension, and then the other three Rangers had to come in, and Bulk and Skull were in there somewhere. I actually think you guys ended up in Lord Zedd's chamber as well, and like somehow you guys, they kind of ended up helping the Power Rangers save Billy from doing a really bad thing. So that would have, it really was, in my opinion, a cool episode, but the one producers were like, they weren't really ready to deal with having people's parents be dead and stuff like that. So,
it sounds awesome.
Yeah, I tell people about it and I keep threatening, oh, I'll post it online because I still have it so people can read it, like a fan fiction thing, and I guess maybe I need to step up to the plate and just do that.
You should.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Can I ask one question?
Yeah, ask them anything you want.
A little more.
Mary, sorry.
Okay, I'm just gonna ask. Looking back now that we're older, because I grew up with you guys, I hope no one gets mad for me saying this. It's odd looking how when we grow up, we can see y'all kind of as we're bullies a little bit. But looking back now that we're older, I think personally that sometimes y'all got bullied more than your actual bullying. And, not necessarily by the, well, you know. I just think y'all did a great job. I really do. Y'all were fun to watch, and growing up and looking back on the episodes, y'all did a lot of character growth. I just want to say thank y'all because
thank
y'all
you.
Were awesome, and it was great.
Well, you've undergone a lot of character growth yourself, sister.
Well, thank you.
Your character used to be what? Four.
At one point, I went from two pigtails to one, and I'm very happy with that character.
I went from one to none. Except for the samurai when I had this thing. Chicken's trying to land on your head.
Will we all be downstairs doing autographs later on? Or?
Never.
Yes.
It was part of the
yes, we are.
Contract.
Yes.
Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
Good
When she goes to the bullying thing, it's interesting. We've said this before that if they reimagined Power Rangers, well, they have, but if they started it fresh now, they might actually make Power Rangers like themselves victims of bullying. Because back then, people didn't really
think of it in terms that they do now, it was still kind of the era of, well, if a bully gives you a bad time, you just need to hit him harder.
Punch him in the neck.
Punch him in the throat, you know? You punch him once or twice, the bully will stop punching you. That worked really well. It's called the Cold War.
It's true. Five-foot civics lesson.
Hi. Hello. Good afternoon, guys. I was wondering if any of y'all have kept up or are aware that there's an IDW Power Ranger comic book coming out, currently ongoing. I was wondering if any of the writers have maybe asked you all for input on maybe things that your characters might say or things that your characters might do. Because I know, like, at the end of every comic issue, there's like a little Bulk and Skull, little ongoing side story also. So, have any of the writers contacted you with questions like that?
No. Although I did see them all in San Diego Comic Con at their table, and I wanted to, well, I demanded to know, frankly, where's the Bulk and Skull trade paperback?
Did they recognize you right off the bat?
I don't care. I just want to know, where's the Bulk and Skull trade paperback? So I asked the question like 7 times. They're like, well, you know, there's a little bit in each issue. If you look at the back, I was like, I don't care. I want the Bulk and Skull trade paperback. So I think eventually we'll get a collective version of all those cool stories. But face it, nobody needs to ask Bulk and Skull about Bulk and Skull, because many of us have a little Bulk and Skull in us, if you know what I mean.
Thank you.
It's a virus.
They did recently, Boom Studios did actually contact me recently, because they're going to be coming out with volumes 5 through 8, like in one big volume.
Okay.
And they asked me to give a little input. They asked me for quotes about what I thought about their comics and stuff like that. So cool. I just did that recently, so that should be coming out soon, I think, on the big volume.
Okay, cool. Keep an eye out for that. Thank you.
Good afternoon, guys. I have a question for you guys. Well, actually, all of you guys. What was your favorite moment in your series, in the Power Rangers?
Payday.
No, I'm just kidding. That depressed us every time.
You know, we all have favorite moments for sure on the show, and I think Narvi's is the episode where he got to play piano and feel like his character actually knew something. And mine was the mini-series Countdown to Destruction, where I got to kick ass for 13 seconds.
13 seconds. I mean, I have a lot of favorite moments, just because I was on the show. I'm sorry.
No, do not apologize for that, David.
I accidentally grabbed him. I thought I was getting the cord. And I'm sorry. Well, I mean, whatever. When you're the same size as a cord. Oh.
According to who? Family just comes from a cord here. You know, that's so cordy. We need an accordion unit. You guys don't like Punch, do you?
Now I forgot the question. Favorite moment?
Yes, your favorite moment.
I mean, I have a lot, because with the original cast, and these guys are part of the original cast, I mean, we had such a great chemistry together, and we got to go through so much together. You weren't on the original pilot, but like when we were doing the original pilot, I mean, it just was like a really awesome experience, and then to go to series and get to grow together as actors and stuff like that, that was cool. But like some of my favorite episodes were like Power Ranger Punks, where Amy Jo and I became punks. Switching Places, where Amy Jo's character, Kimberly and Billy, changed personalities, was fun to film. I don't know. Billy had like 8 girlfriends throughout the series, so those were always fun to film, because he kind of got to kiss them, but not really. Like little cheek kisses, you know? So that was cool. Hey, it meant something. Back in the day. So yeah, I mean, there was a lot. And filming the film, we had a good time in Australia.
That was cool.
Yeah. So we have a lot of good moments. Good question.
All right, this question's for all three of y'all. What was y'all's favorite episode filming?
Well, David's would be when he switched personalities with Amy Jo.
Oh, yeah, I kind of figured that.
See, probably. I listen to you.
I like the ones we did
Well, I mean, I love the Wild West Rangers. That was a blast. That was a lot of. That was really cool.
Easy for you to say. I had to wear eye patch the whole episode. Into things.
And you had to wear an eye patch on a damn mule. That had to be terrifying.
It's only when you'd let me ride
him.
Yeah.
Don't look at me,
I'm ugly. Oh, you have an eye patch. Come on.
I like the other Rangers back in time when we were in the old Sydney town. What was that one called? The Colonial Rangers? Yeah. That was fun. Yeah, I guess it wasn't our favorite. Yeah, where else? Jay? Eat lots of flies.
Yeah.
So there you go. There's a few.
Yeah, eating flies. Funnest moment.
That's a huge belt buckle. Well, it is Texas.
Okay, first I just want to say thank you all for coming out here.
Thank you for having us.
And my question is, what are your thoughts on the cast for the new movie?
On the cast?
Yeah.
I don't know enough about it. A few that I know sound really exciting. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, I'm really excited to see what the cast does. I've had the pleasure and opportunity to meet RJ Seiler, who's going to be playing Billy in the movie, and he's an amazing, talented actor. He's winning awards on all kinds of other stuff that he's doing, so I'm really excited to see like what kind of a star he becomes. But when he and I met, he was saying that they took this very seriously. They took the, because they're doing the original characters, like he's playing Billy, they're gonna have Jason, Kimberly, like everybody that's playing those characters took it very seriously because they know how much the fans respect the show and they want to do it justice. So they're very excited. I'm very excited for them because they're all acting very passionate about it. So I think you guys are going to be pleased with it. So I'm excited to see how it turns out.
Thank you.
Well, my question was a little bit similar to that, but I guess another question I had coming up here, how did you guys have your starts as actors? Me and my girlfriend, we want to become, we're aspiring actors, so we want to know where you guys got your start, how you guys got to where you were.
Sure. Well, you know, when you live in a major media market, like New York, Miami, Los Angeles, Vancouver, and even San Antonio is a major market. So is Houston, Dallas, New Orleans is a huge market. So when you live close in one of those cities, there are certain infrastructures in place that facilitate producers finding talent, producers getting a crew, shooting whatever they want to shoot, and being able to do post-production, right? And that means that there's agents. So how we get our start is we figure out by hook or by crook how to get an agent, then you get some pictures made, get a resume made that shows all of the 14 church plays that I've done, and you just make it sound like they're not church plays, and then your resume is slamming. And then that goes out with your headshot, and your agent tries to get you auditions. And then when you get an audition, they take the time to show up, and you show up and do your best with the material that they give you. So, you know, when people commit
murder,
there's two things that are present: motive and opportunity. You've already demonstrated you have motive. You want to be a professional performer, but do you have an opportunity? And the answer is, you live close to here, you live in town.
I live in Houston, so yeah.
There it is. There's your opportunity. So find out what the local talent agencies are, and that's what they're called, talent agencies. If you can find one that's SAG affiliated, that's good. Try and get an appointment with them. Get some pictures made, do a resume, send out to 5 or 6 of the talent agents, and then call them once a week until they get sick of you and give you an appointment. If you call more than that, they'll call the police.
Well, now these days, I always tell people, because I got a lot of students that are starting to do theater, they also are kind of interested in doing film. And I tell them, well, look, dude, find auditions. I mean, major films are not putting out auditions in the newspapers, but student films are. And there's some, the students of today are going to be the directors of tomorrow.
And Narvi has hit on an important point here, which is there's a ton of acting to be had where you won't make any money, or you make very little money, but it's awesome for experience. And a lot of the community theater applications, theme park work is a great way to get experience too. My suggestion about finding an agent would, I mean, right now you seem to have all of your toes and you're walking reasonably straight and you can speak. You're already way above a lot of the actors out there. So maybe skip doing Death of a Salesman 8 times and try and get a talent agent.
Good luck, go do it.
Thank you, guys.
Get out. Go.
Run.
Good job. You're right.
You mentioned that Samurai,
yes.
What if they invited come back to do Skull as well? Because I noticed they had another character that was supposed to be his nephew or something.
His son.
His son?
Yeah. So what are you asking?
If he asked Jason to come back to do reprise his role as Skull.
They did not.
They did not?
They did not.
Surprised about that.
Because look, in the upcoming season of Power Rangers, you may or may not find two somewhat familiar character archetypes. So this was, Samurai was an attempt that they tried to recreate the idea of the comic antagonists, the buffoonish, Laurel and Hardy types, right? So they were looking for people, they had auditions for months, and at the end they were having a lot of trouble making a decision on who to cast, so they asked me to come in and help with callbacks for the audition. So I directed the callbacks and I gave them a few people out of the batch and said, these...
Wait. Excuse me, you were running the callbacks and then you got the role? Wait a minute! That's more than nepotism! You were sleeping with the casting director!
Every night! So they asked me to come back and help them, and then at the end, they asked me to do one take on camera. Alternate. I played Spike as well as Bark, or whatever they were calling
Bark.
It. Bark and Spike. So at the end, they were like, we don't like any of the fat guys. Please be the fat guy again. So that's why they never even called Jason and asked him to come back in, because it was never intended to be Vulcan Skull. It was intended to be two other Vulcan Skull-esque characters. But you know what? Ask Will Shatner about Chris Pine, all right?
I also have another question. Last time I checked, Bulk was supposed to be on another planet.
Oh, you mean Bulk trapped on Miranoi?
Yeah.
Semantics! Man, a lot of people always want continuity out of their Power Rangers. The kid just disappeared, the robots disappeared. There's, you know, isn't there a giant used car lot in Angel Grove where, like, all the Zords lined up? Yeah, exactly. The building industry in Angel Grove, it's booming all the time. You should get into construction, man. You have a lot of buildings going down every week at 3:30.
So, first of all, thanks for making my childhood awesome. And second of all, if Bulk and Skull were Power Rangers, what colors would they be?
It's so funny how people are so obsessed with color.
Leather!
They put color, that's a texture, Paulie. If I were to be like, okay, he's gonna be brown, what the hell? He'd be like, oh, brown.
Brown.
I mean, really doesn't matter to you. Doesn't really matter to you.
Well,
be honest.
He asked a question.
Okay, fine. What color is your underwear?
What are you wearing right now? Show us.
Let me see it. You wear a bra with that? It makes you feel comfortable, doesn't it, when we go inside your brain?
Oh, man, I don't know. This poop color? Just brown?
As long as there's green involved, I'm okay.
Thanks for
the question. Gentlemen, thank you for coming. Adding on to kind of the last gentleman's question, whereas y'all did make my childhood great, I had a question about the Zords. Like, for you, David, did you like the Triceratops being your creature? Or did you have one that you would have rather picked?
Well, I mean, we didn't get any say in any of it, but I was very happy with the Triceratops. I think the Triceratops was a pretty cool dinosaur.
What kind of mileage did it get?
It was actually sort of a hybrid, so it was around 50 miles to the gallon.
Did it have to get the auto dudes up the pipes?
Yeah.
Lower that thing, dude. Close order.
It did it all. But the unicorn was an interesting one to have, and I had a unicorn as well. I was the unicorn.
What were you, in an 80s heavy metal band?
Unicorn Thunderzord power now.
Unicorn
And the wolf from the movie was pretty cool, but I did like the Triceratops. I wouldn't want to be any other thing.
And if y'all could have Zords, what would you like your special creature to be?
Hot dogs.
I want to be kind of one.
Missile launchers of mustard and ketchup. That would be awesome. All good ideas.
Hello, thanks for coming out. I have a question about the first movie. You guys skydived in the opening sequence. Was that actually you?
Yeah.
How was that?
It was amazing, because it was only like a 5-foot drop. But no, in the airplane, it was us inside of an airplane, but it was an airplane that was sitting in a room like this, and literally when we jumped out of the plane, it was like jumping off the stage onto a mat.
But it was also like 3 a.m.
Yeah, probably.
So our depth perception was off.
Yeah, so when you see us flying through the sky, though, that's not actually us. That's a stunt double. Sorry to ruin the magic.
Damn.
That's movie magic.
In that scene, there's a really funny bit. We really did shoot that at like 3 o'clock in the morning because the production was super behind and they were not done with the set. So they made us all sit around and wait for them to finish painting the interior of the airplane. So when they call us to set, we're all on the set. Watch that scene again, you'll notice nobody touches the walls. Nobody, and in fact, people are looking like a little bit like, where's the wall? Whoa, it's because they're like, the paint is wet. If you touch the wall, you're gonna mess up the costume, you're gonna have to stay here all night. So everyone's like, oh my God, I can't touch the wall, I can't touch the wall. And so, you know, no, we're not allowed to skydive. And you know the reason why is because insurance. Because when you have stars of the movie that decide to go scuba diving during the course of production, and then something happens and they're dead, that really messes up filming the movie. So in the contract that you sign when you join a movie production, and this is true for all films and some TV shows, you're not allowed to rent a motorcycle, no jet skis, no bungee jumping, no skydiving, no nothing. Like, you can't even pick your nose because they're like, Wade, what are you doing? So because they don't want you to break yourself, and that would cost them millions of dollars. So.
Did you like your costumes in that opening sequence?
Yeah, sure. Yeah. I like the skinny guy in a fat suit. Yeah.
We love him so much, we took him home with us.
That's true.
Thank you, Fox. The long blue one.
Hi.
Hi. That's my sword.
Three. Precisely three. That's not very many. I'm sorry. First, I feel like I need to apologize because I hated Vulcan Skulls for so long.
Me too.
Like, I'm so sorry.
Hey, can I just finish for you?
Yeah.
You hated Vulcan Skull because they were mean bullies and you were bullied. And then when you grew up and watched the show again, you realized that the Rangers kind of suck. And the only reason you watch the show now is because of Vulcan Skull. Right? Okay, thanks. Sit down.
So the show has a very positive influence on me growing up. But David specifically, I know that you didn't always have the most positive experiences working on it, but knowing that so many fans had such like a love for it, do you ever have a hard time like dealing with the kind of dissimilarity between your experiences and our experiences? Like, does it ever like?
No, I mean, obviously, when we started the TV, we had no idea that our characters would have such an influence on so many of you, and that you would actually count on us to teach you morals and stuff like that. So the fact that you guys come and tell us stories about how Power Rangers helped you through difficult times, we hear so many stories about people that come from broken homes and Power Rangers was their one saving grace, or they got into martial arts because of Power Rangers, or because I was Billy, they became scientists or paleontologists, like all these crazy doctors and stuff like that. It's like, it's so humbling for us. So I honestly have no, you know, what was going on with me was going on with me, and you know, I dealt with it the way that I needed to deal with it, but it doesn't change my feelings towards the show or my experience in terms of like the gratitude that I get from fans. So it's awesome. And so I like to hear that you guys got something amazing out of the TV show.
That's great. Good question.
Honestly, want to say, you guys were my three favorite characters on the show. Like, seriously.
Yeah, hey, this is the three outsiders right here.
Yeah.
Right?
I wanted to ask, what was the hardest thing during shooting for you guys? You know, during the show.
The hardest thing?
Yeah, Jason, like the hardest.
The hardest component of my life. Well, I think for Jason Nardi and I, the waiting around work. Because you can only listen to Jesus Christ Superstar so many times. And that's the only record we have for like 5 years.
We got a record player in our dressing room. How old does that make us? But we couldn't get any reception. We couldn't get K-Rock, and the hell if we were going to take the tapes out of our
car cassette tapes.
Wow. Old. Yeah, those hours were brutal. They were brutal. We shot so fast. So much so fast. We shot one episode every 2.5 days at one point.
Wow.
I mean, that's ridiculous. So we're doing seven days a week. We were working. So that was brutal.
Yeah, I mean, they're right. The hours were the toughest. And we shot 4 episodes at one time. So they're called clusters. And so, like, everything that you see in the command center, we do for every episode, we would shoot, like, for 4 episodes in the command center. And then we'd just keep rotating sets, and then we'd go out on location and shoot everything for those 4 episodes. So it's a little confusing, too, like, trying to keep, you're bouncing back and forth. The girls always had hair changes. It just took a lot of time. So, you know, 12, 15-hour days sometimes. Was
normal. It was a cluster.
It was definitely a cluster. I feel bad because I feel like we're all turned this way, but I want to look to you guys too and recognize you and thank you for being here. So thank you.
Hey. I didn't say stop. I just wanted to hit you at the same time.
Okay. Does that answer your question? Yeah.
Good question about Dave.
All right. So I was completely serious whenever I came up with this idea to make a bike that has magnetic rims. And the fork for the bike tire, like the body of it, is, I guess, copper coils, so that whenever the wheel rotates, it creates an electrical charge. And then you have like an electrical powered bicycle at the same time because you're creating the electrical force.
Are you here to ask a question or are you selling a product?
Well, I was wondering if Billy knew it would work. do you think my bike would work?
It sounds like it would work if you have some kind of a component to store the energy as you're creating the energy, and then a capacitor, a flux capacitor, and but yeah, so like that, and then you know you have a button that you push when you don't personally want to be pedaling anymore. You push the button and the electricity takes over. Sounds amazing. It's a hybrid.
It's called a motorcycle.
Or I think it's a moped. But it sounds like a good idea. I like the magnetic thing. That sounds interesting.
Good question.
So, great.
Thank you.
You're welcome. I was wondering who else thought the explosions were super cool?
The explosion?
Like, they never hit you, but you're like...
You mean like with the putties? Or the
like
Zords?
Your blasters.
The blade blasters?
Yeah.
Yeah, you thought it was cool?
But y'all, yeah, because they never hit you, but you're like...
You gotta jump out of the way, man. You don't want to get hit.
Oh, okay.
That's what it's about.
Yeah, because they were gallon milk containers full of gasoline.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Oh, like Joe Dirt? Joe Dirt. What?
Okay, next!
Good question, man.
What?
Hey, I just gotta, just like everybody else, I gotta reiterate how great it was growing up in the 90s with you guys. Billy made being a nerd cool and acceptable and part of the family. You know, you weren't like outcasted. You turned around, you were always part of the team. Bulk and Skull, they showed that like even at their worst, you could still turn around and be good and help the team, even though you realized you were doing bad, so you would do, you know, you would end up helping the Rangers. But I just recently, it brought tears to my eyes watching one of the final scenes with everybody together was y'all sat around in Ernie's smoothie bar singing, and Amy Jo Johnson, Kimberly was playing the guitar. And I just wanted to know, like, do y'all still have that same kind of chemistry? I know y'all are working on The Order, and a lot of the old Power Ranger cast is working on that movie, and I'm really excited for it. But when y'all finally got back together like that, was all the chemistry still the same? Did y'all, like, you know, jump right back in, or was there some button heads or anything like that working on the movie?
Well, I mean, I pretty much hate everybody, so it's... I'm just kidding. I'm good friends with everybody still, I think. I mean, I think once there's chemistry, there's always chemistry. And so, I mean, it's like, with the original cast, for sure, we just really had awesome chemistry. And I think, like, when we see each other, we just pick right up. And fortunately, for many of us, we go to a lot of Comic-Cons, so we get to see each other all the time. But it was a lot of fun to work on The Order. And if you don't know about it, I think there's 18 to 20 former Power Rangers in this movie that we're filming. And it'll be coming out next year, so keep your eye out for it. But and it's Rangers from different series, but there are many of us from the original cast that are in it. And, you know, it was just a lot of fun to do a movie where we're not playing our Power Ranger characters, we're playing something totally different, and we get to kick butt, and, you know, we're still doing it. It's an action movie, so it's a lot of fun. But yeah, I would say the chemistry is there, and even more so, I think, from the years have gone by, because we've been through so much together and got to grow together and go through Hollywood together and all that.
Yeah, I mean, it is odd. I mean, these you think of your oldest friends, and I'm not talking your friends who are 80 years old that you met last week, you know. He's my oldest friend. I met him at McDonald's about 2 hours ago. All right, you go do that. Good luck to you. I'm going to borrow this walker because I got a skateboard thing. But the people that you've known the longest, and at this point in our lives, it is each other. I mean, that's the truth. And like David said, there's only so many people you can share that particular strange experience for that 5 years where you got to pretend like you were famous, you know? So, yeah, the bonds have gotten stronger, I think, you know? It's the only continuity most of us have in our lives.
That's great. Thanks, guys. I can't wait for the movie.
Hey, yeah, thanks for coming down, guys. Just like everybody else said, we grew up with you, you know, and it was awesome watching that stuff. I mean, I remember playing out on the kindergarten, you know, out on the playground when I was a kid, and everybody played Power Rangers. That's what we did for the 30, 40 minutes that we were out there every day. So that was a huge part of my childhood. I got a couple of questions for you. I know a couple of years ago, there was a fan fiction movie that came out that was a very dark set, you know, after the fact Power Rangers thing. And I know there was a little bit of controversy over it because a lot of people were like, oh, it's such a children's story and they're doing something terrible with it. But I know with me, it being an adult now, it was one of those things that I thought it was really cool to see, I guess, that continuation of it becoming an adult thing. I wondered if how many of you saw it and what your thoughts on were it, if it was...
So you don't mean the Vanderbeek one where I was on heroin. The one before that where the Pink Ranger helmet is like in the dirt.
Post-apocalyptic style, is that the one you mean?
Yeah, the post-apocalyptic.
You know,
that was fun. No, different one. Yeah, no, there's been a few of them. You know, the thing with that is, like, I appreciate being grown-ups now that we all kind of want a little bit of a darker turn on things that were kind of in our minds when we were younger. But I'm always disappointed when I see people spend $100,000 making a film project based on somebody else's intellectual property when your ideas are better than someone else's ideas, because then you spend that money and you create your own pantheon and you create your own creative inertia. And it, because a lot of people are like, oh man, I like Batman, I want to do a Batman thing. Well, you know, all you got to do is just change 20% of what that story is, and you can make your own thing, you're still in the clear legally, and you own it.
I'll be Catman.
Catman.
He lives in...
Hey, please do. Catman do.
Catman do. I'll do Catman do.
Do.
And my last question is, like, after the initial series was over, what kind of things did you all get involved in before, you know, bringing back any of your characters or getting back involved with the system?
Cheap Power Ranger reboots done for $100,000, stealing someone else's intellectual property. Seasoned with a lot of tears.
What Jason means is he went to college to get his PhD, which he got.
This is Dr. Nardi.
Put your hand in, cough.
Oh, sir, I don't...
cough, please.
I don't really need to... My throat hurts.
So yeah, I mean, you can see it from that angle, Doc. Don't worry about it. Yeah, so it was an odd time. It was like adult puberty.
Yes.
You look yourself in the mirror every day, you're like, what is happening?
Right? And then your mom's like, you need to get out.
You need to get out. Like, but I was so well adjusted.
You know what, here's the thing with show business. There's a lot of stereotypes about it, but it is very insular. You know, it is a warm, safe space where people bring you whatever you need when you're an actor or a director or a producer. And the moment that you step out of that weird mission to Mars test, you feel very different because nobody cares what you want for breakfast, and nobody cares what you wear,
and you can touch your face again because you're not wearing a bunch of makeup. And I mean, for years, like, none of us would touch our faces. Like, we're trained, right, you know, to not do that. And then people would, you know, say, hey, you got something on? I'm like, no, don't touch me! Oh, wait, that was a year ago. I'm not acting anymore. So it is a transition, but it's a good transition because it brings you back into the land of people who pump gas and people that go shopping for groceries. And it's good. It's, you know what? It's a great dream to live and an amazing experience for all of us. But I think we're all very pleased that we did come back down to earth a little bit and forge our own path ahead. Because show business is like a giant sea freighter. It has an inertia to it when you're on this boat. And a lot of times, no matter if you try to turn the wheel, you can't, right? On a big ship, you turn the wheel, it's not going to turn forever. And that's what show business feels like.
So what he's saying is eventually you're going to hit an iceberg. And no one will know or remember you for about 80 years. James Cameron pokes his head into your grave. This is getting dark.
Until you're on the rock.
There you go. So we have, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4. This will be our final 4 questions, but we got to start doing a speed round because we have like 10 minutes.
Girl was waiting in line.
Not anymore. Hello?
Have any of you ever had any sort of paranormal experience?
Having one right now.
Why do you ask that question?
I don't know. It's just something I've always wondered with celebrities.
Why do you ask that question? Because there's something right behind you, David!
I certainly believe in paranormal experiences. I would think I've had a few, for sure. I would say, to be an actor, I did have a paranormal experience. After I graduated from college, I was living in Northern California, but I really wanted to move to Los Angeles to be an actor. And I can remember I was driving down the freeway, and some weird voice came to me and said, move to LA in 2 weeks. And I didn't even question it. I went and quit my job that day. I gave him 2 weeks' notice, and I moved to LA in 2 weeks. I was in town for 3 months, and I got Power Rangers. So. So sometimes, listen to those voices. I mean, I can honestly say it was a voice that's not my own voice. It wasn't like weird or anything like that. It was just so peaceful, and it just told me to do it, and I was like, okay, I'm in. So that's cool. One of my paranormal experiences. Cool. Yeah. What about you? How many ghosts?
Well, I don't know about ghosts, but I've got about 35 skeletons in my closet. In Hamlet, Hamlet says, there are more things in heaven and earth than are dreamt of in man's philosophy. And I think that we as a species strive to identify, categorize, understand systems and processes, but ultimately our ignorance is boundless. And there's, you know, the mystery of God and the other side and other dimensions and other realms, I think, is a palpable one that we have, as a species, always tried to pierce the veil. But there's only one moment when you'll really know, and that's when you go over there.
God, it got dark again! Speed round, let's do it!
Hi, I'm Colton. I got a question. No, my question is, There's an actual time when, I don't know if y'all remember, that Bulk and Skull actually became heroes, or like for like, I think an episode or something, where they actually became Power Rangers or something like that, and they worked in the Megazords. When y'all heard that script was coming, how did y'all actually feel about that? Like,
we didn't have our driver's license yet, so we were terrified. Next!
Colton, it's impossible to double park a sword.
Impossible. Evening, gentlemen. I just had a question for you. Who was responsible for color coordinating the Power Rangers with each actor?
David, next!
How did you guys feel about the Bulk and Skull theme song?
Paulie loved it, I hated it. Next!
Oh my gosh. So the answer to the question about the colors thing, honestly, when we found out what it was, when Jason and I found out, we were like, wow, that just seems really stereotypical and a little bit weird. Definitely on the line, if not over the line. But consider the time.
You know, that would never fly today, and that's why your new Power Rangers cast is mixed up a little bit, and we're not making an Asian girl play the Yellow Ranger.
Well, then, okay. that Ramona Hayim Saban is Israeli. He was born in Egypt.
Please. Not now. I was about to say that. Okay.
Well, theoretically speaking, they don't look at race in the same way in other countries as we do here.
That is true.
You know, we really are, we've struggled with it in ways that other countries have not. Therefore, we're very sensitive to it in ways that other countries aren't, better or worse. And that was always what they said is the excuse. Yeah. I don't know that any of us believed it, but that was what we were told.
Well, the original,
like when we first were cast for the pilot, the original Yellow Ranger was actually a Latina girl. She was never Asian. So once she was fired and they hired Tui, it just was a bad coincidence. That's all. And so with the Black Ranger being the Black Ranger, it just was never even a thought process in terms of
Black Power Ranger.
You got that. So, yeah. So anyways, were we going to answer anything else? The theme song to Vulcan Skull was an amazing theme song.
Yeah, no, thank you, Ron Wasserman. Hey, give it. Hey, would you get that thing out of your shorts? That show business. I wasn't really pulling that. You guys, remember Power Rangers when you first saw it? You were like, man, this is cheesy. Man, this is cheesy. And then after a few months, you're like, man, this is cheesy. And now you're like, this is cheesy! And I think that same thing happened to us. When we first started working on it, we were like, oh my God, no. Man, really? And then it grows on you because it's an accepting universe. And that's the great message of the show, is teamwork and acceptance and unconditional friendship. So.
And then you get your own theme song.
That goes like this. Doom, 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 doom. Thank you for coming to our panel.
And please, if you haven't come down to our tables downstairs, come down to our tables, say hi to us, get autographs, take pictures, whatever. We'd love to talk with you and hug you and all that good stuff, all right?
Okay.
I know.
Sure.